church. We're excited you guys are here this morning, and we just want to just welcome you to this online experience this morning. The question we're going to ask you guys today is, what of your rights would you go to the wall for? What rights would you go to the wall for? And Pastor's going to preach through that this morning, and I'm just looking forward to hearing what God's Word has to say about that. I want to make sure you guys jump into the digital connection card this morning. Some of you guys are hesitant to fill that out, but it just takes a little click of your finger. Just click on that digital connection card and go in and let us know you are watching, you're here. And also, if you have a prayer request, there's a place for you to fill in that information as well. So definitely click on that. It's in the description right below the video, so make sure you guys do that. This week on Sunday, actually coming up tomorrow, or today, I guess, we're going to have a prayer time, and it's going to be at 2 o'clock, and it's going to be, weather permitting, out on the grass out behind the kids area there. And if the weather's not awesome, it's going to be in the parking lot. So either way, love to have you guys all come at 2 o'clock. There's an email that was sent out with all kinds of things you need to know about that, so check that out as well. And then finally this morning, at the end of the video, you're going to have a chance to see Batman and the Kids Corner. So get your kids at the very end of the video, bring them around, and let them have a chance to hear from Batman and the Kids Corner. Let me pray for us as we start into our worship time. God, I just thank you so much that you love us, God. And in this time, God, where there's a lot of questions, God, you answer all those questions in your word. And God, I just pray as we engage with the singing time now, the music, and we have an opportunity to worship you, God, I pray that you would just speak to our hearts right where we're at this morning. I pray that we would have the humility, God, to tell you where we're at this morning, just to tell you our fears and our concerns, God, and also to just tell you that we love you. God, we are in awe of you this morning. I pray that as we sing and play and God, that we worship you, that you would just hear our hearts this morning. We love you. In your name we pray. Amen.
I see his body breaking. I see his fingers bleeding. I see the darkness tremble at the ground below his feet. And in the darkest hour, there on Calvary, he was sweetly broken, broken, beautiful, broken, beautiful. So come back to the waters, come back to broken sea. Come on, sons and daughters, his love changes everything. Come when the fear is right, find me the risen King. Come on and let the light in, your love changes everything. If the heavens open, all the skins are red. Come down to glory, as it died and rose again. The darkest hour, it's the time you know. I will feel no evil. You'll never let me go. Come out to the water. Don't let the broken sea. Come on, sons and daughters. His love changes everything. Come when the fear is fighting, finding the risen King. Come on and let the light, your love changes everything. Your love changes everything. Your love, In the valley of, I will fear no evil, 'cause you'll never let me go, you'll never let me go. My heart needs a surgeon. My
to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 running into your arms is running to life from death. And I feel this rush deep in my chest. Your mercy is all. Thank you, Jesus. Just as I am, you pull me in. And I know I need unto the Father. I want to the Father of falling in grace. I'm done with the hiding, easy to wait. My heart needs a friend, my soul needs a friend. So I want to the Father again and again. So I run to the Father of falling in grace. Reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon. My soul needs a friend. So I come to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, 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 oh. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the heart, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again and again and again.
God, we just thank you as, God, we just look into the world right now, and it's almost painful to watch the news, but God, just to realize that you are absolutely still in control. And God, I think sometimes we need to take that lyric and say, God, we just need to run to you and just sit in your arms and just bask in the knowledge, God, that you are absolutely in control. Just thank you.
And all the lost along the way, and all the fears we come to face, I know that you are holy. Know that you are holy. And don't we see our hallelujah, and we will cry out hallelujah. Dawn hearts to our content. Dawn feel unworthy. Dawn hurt with nothing left. Know that you are holy. And all we sing out hallelujah, and we cry out hallelujah, and all we sing out hallelujah, and we cry out hallelujah. Go on and tell it to the masses. The edge. And shout. Go on and scream it from the mountains. Go on and tell it to the masses that He is God. Oh, and shout. Oh, go on and scream it from the mountains. Oh, go on and tell it to the masses.
Moon and stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, His blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon Him. Final breath He gave, as heaven was revealed. The Son of God was laid in darkness. The battle and the grave, the war on death was waged. The power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake. The stone was rolled away. His perfect love could not be overcome. Now, death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever He is glorified. Forever. Yeah.
God, we just thank you again so much for the privilege that we have to come before you, God, and worship. God, to sing songs and to play instruments, and God, just to lift your name up in one accord. And God, whether we're sitting in different places now or we're all together, it really doesn't matter, God, because you are everywhere and you hear us. God, I thank you for that. And I just pray now as Pastor comes and speaks, God, that you would speak through him. God, I pray that our hearts would be open and, God, that we'd be able to hear what you have to say to us today. God, speak clearly. Help us to be available to what you have for us. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Trusting that you're having a good week and a blessed weekend. And we are looking forward to studying God's Word today. And this afternoon at 2 o'clock, we are hopefully going to see some of you out for our prayer meeting. And we are really excited about that, to be able to pray for our country right now during this difficult time. So let me start out by telling you a story. It actually was from a book Robert Schuller had written many years ago called The Be Happy Attitude. Let me just read what he wrote. Born over 100 years ago in Yugoslavia, she responded to God's call on her life while still a teenager. A missionary's strong challenge to give her life to teaching in India resulted in her appointment to the city of Calcutta. Some months later, she saw a sight which completely revolutionized her life and would ultimately bring her worldwide fame. What was that sight? A homeless, dying woman lying in the gutter being eaten by rats. That permanently changed Mother Teresa's heart. Compassion compelled her to beg an abandoned Hindu temple from the government and convert it into a crude makeshift hospital for the dying. Her comment became her life's thrust. If there is a God in heaven and a Christ we love, nobody should die alone. Later on, some Hindu priests tried to shut down her hospital that was in this abandoned Hindu temple. But then one of the Hindu priests got tuberculosis, and the local hospital wouldn't accept him as he was getting close to death. But guess who went over and retrieved him? Mother Teresa and her nuns. And they brought her to her makeshift hospital and cared for that Hindu priest until he passed. And when she did that act of love, it changed the whole city of Calcutta towards them. She was an amazing example of Christ's love and servanthood. Malcolm Muggeridge from the BBC once interviewed Mother Teresa and asked, "Mother Teresa, the thing I noticed about you and the hundreds of sisters who now form your team is that you always look so happy. Is that a put-on?" And she replied, "Oh no, not at all. Nothing makes you happier than when you really reach out in mercy to someone who is badly hurt." Wow. Mother Teresa, what an example. Well, today we are discussing the third key to how to recover joy in the journey. We're discussing the third key. Let's look at Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. This is what it says. Let's click up. There we go. Look at verse 3 at the bottom of the screen. It says, "Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourself. Let each of you look out not only for his own interests, but also for the interests of others." Here is the big idea today. The third key to recovering joy is to take the role of a sacrificial servant and put others ahead of yourself. Take the role of a sacrificial servant and put others ahead of yourself. How is that possible? How can we possibly do that? I need to tell you an interesting story. Yesterday morning, I called to a popular hair salon in town and made an appointment online, and they said, "We can take you in 3 hours and give you a haircut." So I showed up at that hair salon 3 hours later when I had that appointment, and they had taken out all the inside waiting room chairs, and you had to stand outside that hair salon until your appointment was ready. And when I got there, guess what? They still were behind. Do you know I waited there another hour and a half to get a haircut? But I saw a lot of upset people. In fact, I later heard that someone had come before I ever got there, yelled at one of the beauticians for several minutes. And so when I was talking to them and waiting, I just made the comment, passing comment, I said, "Thanks, you guys. You are doing a great job." I just said that to the beauticians. And then later, when my turn came up and I sat down in the barber chair, the gal that was tending to me almost started crying, just saying, "You have no idea what you said to us." And I said, "What?" She said, "That was so comforting because we were just ready to give up. It was so discouraging how upset people were, and we're just doing the best we can." And I thought about this. It's like going, wow, taking the role of a sacrificial servant and putting others ahead of yourself. Well, do you know why I made that nice comment to that those beauticians is because as I was waiting in the parking lot, waiting for my turn, grinding my teeth, I had my sermon in my hand I was reviewing. And all of a sudden, the Lord kind of nudged me on the head saying, McFly, wake up. Be nice to these gals. They're doing the best they can. Okay, so the passage today tackles the question, how can we possibly fulfill this key to joy? Take on the role of a servant and put others ahead of ourselves. Well, Paul shares with us three things that need to happen in our heart and mind to truly take on the role of a servant and be other-centered. Here are the three things that need to happen in our heart and mind. First, we must surrender to the Lord's passionate love for us. Let's go back and look at Philippians 2:1. This is what it says. So if there is any encouragement in Christ, if there is any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection or sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each one look not only for their own interests, but also for the interests of others. Now, can you click back to the first screen there for a second, the verse 1? There we go. Now, look at that. It says, so if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy. That Greek word if in Greek grammar is in the first class condition, meaning it's already assumed is true. So what the verse is really saying in the Greek is it's not saying if, like we're not sure. It's saying since you have already been united with Christ and experienced his encouragement. Since you have already tasted the love of Christ and filled your heart with Christ's love. Since you have fellowship with the Holy Spirit. Since you've experienced God's tenderness and compassion through the Lord Jesus Christ. Because of all these things, put others ahead of yourselves. Meaning, what Paul is saying, since you've already received this, you've been filled to the full with the love of God in you. Let that overflow to others. Pass on what God has already put in you. Look at Galatians 2:20. Look at Galatians 2:20. Look at what Paul says. We oftentimes miss the end of this verse. Paul says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live. We sometimes stop there and say, yep, that's it. I need to just die to myself. Blah, 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 blah. That's not what the passage is saying. Let's keep going. He says, it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live to the full by faith in the Son of God. Why do I live it to the full by faith? Because it is Christ who loved me and gave himself for me. You see, our capacity to set aside ourselves and focus on others is totally conditioned on us first having our cup filled by the love of Jesus Christ. We pass on what he first gave us. Second thing that needs to happen in our hearts and minds is we need to let Christ, who is now in us, we need to let the Spirit of Christ not only live in us and work in us, but work through us to bless and shine on others. Look at Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8. Paul says, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, meaning in the very nature of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. So what Paul is saying is a great truth. Can we go back to verse 5 there a second? Verse 5. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours already in Christ Jesus. Here's a great truth. Your capacity to be a sacrificial servant to others is totally dependent on whose mind is in you. Verse 5 tells you, you have the mind of Christ, the mind of the Spirit in you, and you can choose who rules your heart. It's either the mind of the flesh or the mind of the Spirit. It is yours to choose. And Paul says, because you've got Christ in you, let the mind of the Spirit, let the mind of Christ rule and dictate what happens in your heart. It is when if you are in the mind of the Spirit, the mind of Christ, you are going to serve others in a way that Jesus served you. Why? Because Jesus Christ is the ultimate, consummate servant. That's why. And this passage breaks down how Jesus modeled true servanthood to us. Jesus served us in 5 ways as a model for us to then learn how to serve others when we take on the mind of Christ in the mind of the Spirit. The first way he served us is Jesus was not an insecure person. He was not insecure. He didn't come into the world needy, focusing on his needs. Meet my needs, meet my needs. He knew who he was. He knew his true identity, and he was secure in it. Jesus knew he was God the Son, and that he was eternally loved by the Father. And that secure identity freed him to focus on ministering to our needs. He didn't come to earth trying to impress, prove, justify, or defend himself. He was secure in the Father's love, and that freed him to focus on being other-centered in serving our needs. And that Spirit is in us. So when we drink from the well of God's love, it frees us from our own self-consciousness to focus on others, saying, what do they need? Jesus filled my cup, but what do they need? So now I can pass it on. I don't have to focus on my needs. I can focus on theirs. Second way that Jesus modeled servanthood is he laid aside his rights and prerogatives as being part of the Godhead for the sake of love. He laid aside his rights and his prerogatives as part of the Godhead for the sake of love. Jesus went so far as to empty himself of his rights as God Almighty, meaning he freely chose to limit the full expression of his glory. He also chose to lay aside the independent use of some of his divine attributes so he could come. He could walk among us clothed in frail humanity. And he could serve us and care about us and be with us. You see, Jesus was fully human, yet without sin. But he was always fully God. He never laid aside his deity. He was always fully God. But he became fully human, yet without sin, for our sake. How can we grasp this? C.S. Lewis, in kind of his whimsical way, gives us a picture here. He says, the second person, this is in the book Mere Christianity, C.S. Lewis says, the second person in God, the Son, became human himself, was born into the world as an actual man, a real man of particular height, with hair of a particular color, speaking a particular language, weighing so many stones. The eternal being who knows everything, who created the whole universe, became not only a man, but before that, a baby. Before that, a fetus inside a woman's body. If you want to get the hang of it, think how you would like to become a slug or a crab. How can we fathom the love that God showed us in his son by Jesus leaving the throne of heaven and coming in frail humanity to love us and to be a sacrifice for our sins? Third way that Jesus modeled servanthood to us is he walked among us to identify and empathize with our struggles. Part of the reason why he came in humanity, so he could identify with us, so he could show in person care and compassion and empathy. You know what empathy is? It's putting yourself in somebody else's shoes and feeling what they must be feeling. And valuing that and caring about that. That's empathy. And Jesus was the ultimate example of empathy by coming clothed in human flesh. He learned what it meant to be thirsty and hungry and cold and lonely and rejected and fearful or sad or depressed or tempted. You see, he even experienced injustice and mistreatment and physical suffering at the hands of those he came to serve. Jesus came to identify with our hardships. Wow. What an ultimate example of love. Fourth way Jesus modeled servanthood is he humbled himself before us, taking the role of a servant. That Greek word humble I need to talk about. That Greek word humble in this passage I need to talk about. This is the word. It's tapienophrosune. Tapienophrosune. This is what it literally means. Lowliness of mind. In the ancient Greek culture, that was a very negative term. When you accuse somebody of being humble in the secular Greek culture, you accuse them of having weak character and being a coward. Jesus took that term and elevated it to make it a heavenly virtue of great honor. In fact, a character quality attributed to God the Son. Humble. You see, that's our calling, to be lowly of mind and to take the role of a servant. And then fifth and finally, he suffered for us. He suffered the ultimate rejection by us. He was crucified between two criminals in the most painful, torturous way. And he was crucified by the very people he came to love and serve. But his death paid the penalty for our sins as our substitute, so we could be reconciled to God. Romans 5:10 says it this way. It says, "For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved." Do you notice how Romans 5:10 refers to you and I? If while we were still enemies, Jesus came and died for enemies because of love, because he wanted them reconciled to God. You see, that's sacrificial love. That's sacrificial love. So when you and I take on the mind of Christ, and we have experienced what Jesus did for us in verses 5 through 8, then guess what? The love we pass on to others is going to smell and taste and feel like the sacrificial servant love of Jesus Christ. So the Spirit is going to give us a sense of security, enough sense of security so that we can get out of ourselves and focus on others instead of on ourselves. Because we're already secure in God's love, so we can be other-centered like our Savior. Secondly, when the Spirit of Christ is in us, and we have the mind of Christ, we will be able to lay aside our rights and our prerogatives for the sake of love. we can lay aside our rights and our prerogatives for the sake of love, because that's the very thing Jesus did for us. Third, we will be able to reach out and show genuine empathy to those that are going through hardships. We're able to get out of ourselves and enter another person's world and identify with their struggles, try to understand the hardships they go through, and show genuine care and mercy and compassion for that, like Mother Teresa did. And then finally, we can embrace the lowly position as a servant, as a humble servant, and serve others, even at the risk of being mistreated by them. Reaching out and serving others, even at the risk of being rejected, like our Savior was. Because we're doing it for the sake of love. And then, the third and last thing that needs to happen in our hearts is we must find our glory in His glory. We must find our glory in His glory. Look at verses 9 through 11. It says, therefore, God has highly exalted Him and bestowed on Him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, and in heaven and earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. You see, we must find our glory in His glory. If you and I seek glory here, we can't be a servant for Jesus Christ. If we love only those that are comfortable to love, if we only love those that are beautiful, that are easy to love because they love us back, that's not being a sacrificial servant like Jesus Christ. If we only love and serve people that improve our station in life, that's not sacrificial servant. Look at what Jesus says in Luke 9:23. He says, and He said to all, if anyone would come after Me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow Me. You guys, look at that verse. And He said to all, if anyone would come after Me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow Me. Do we have Colossians 3? Let's put that up a minute, because I want to show you God cares about you getting glory. But if you want His glory, you can't seek it here. You've got to wait till He returns. Look at what this verse says. It says, if then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on the things that are above, not on the things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with Him in glory. So let me close. If there was ever a time in America, in my lifetime, that we needed to stop focusing on our needs, if there was ever a time in America where we need to stop demanding our rights and prerogatives, but instead be willing to accept the humble role of a servant and follow Jesus in loving the broken, caring for the weak, reaching out to the marginalized, and showing true empathy to the hurting. It is right now. There was ever a time in American history where we needed people to set aside their rights, their needs, their demands, and become a servant. It's right now. Church, we need to stand up. We need to accept our call to radical discipleship. We need to accept the role of a humble servant of Jesus Christ and put the needs of others above ourselves. There is a stalemate happening in our nation right now. there is all these different groups. We're so polarized. And everybody has nuggets of truth. But everybody has gone to the extreme to react to something else. And we're so divided. What is going to bring us together? When the church wakes up and takes on the role of our Savior and does what Paul said, let this mind be in you that was in Jesus. When that happens, when the church starts acting like the church, I think our nation can start to heal and be unified. Let's be that catalyst, okay? Father, thank you. Thank you, Lord, for this challenge. I could not think of a passage of Scripture more important right now for us as Christians, Lord, to be reminded of what our high calling is. Our high calling is to follow in the footsteps of our Savior Jesus and to be humble servants and to lay aside our needs, our rights, our demands, our wants, and to reach out to the broken and the hurting and the marginalized and show true empathy and to serve them and to gently point them to Jesus, because that is our only ultimate hope. Lord, may you use us as your servants. May we be your hands and feet. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. This is Mr. Type. Batman. I hope you're all taking good care of yourself and washing your hands. A lot. You can kind of do it like I do it. You know, wash hands. I'm here to answer some questions raised in a letter sent to me by one of our viewers. For those wondering, no. It was not Adam Lightbody this time. And actually, for the record, I did not tell Adam Lightbody that he could use the Batcave for next year's lock-in. Adam, please quit telling people that. Anyway, back to my letter. Dear Mr. Batman, I think you're really great. Wow, I like this person already. And I really need some advice. A guy from school called me weak because I love Jesus. He called Jesus weak too. He said Jesus never acted like a big shot, never ordered anyone around, was never mean to anyone, all because he was weak. Is that right? Was Jesus weak? Am I weak to think and act like Jesus? Please help. Your friend, Citizen. Dear Citizen, Jesus is not weak, and neither are you. It was a good thing that you did, just sending in your letter and asking your questions. That already tells me that you want to know more about Jesus, and that, my friend, is a good place to start. Take it from me, smart people, ask questions, and even smarter people wait around for the answers. Actually, I just made that up, but I think we can all agree it's genius. So friend, your question reminds me of something that I read in the Bible. It was from chapter 2 of the book of Philippians. It's about Jesus, and it says that he was humble. Not weak, humble. So ask your dad or your mom or some other superhero with a Bible to show you where to find the book of Philippians. It's in the New Testament. Ask them to read it with you and go to chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. Now what you're about to learn is a very valuable lesson, and it starts with a single word. Humble. Jesus was humble. And to be like Jesus, we need to be humble too. Really? Jesus was humble. That's the beginning to all the answers to all these hard questions? Yes, absolutely. So what does that mean for us? Humble. What is humble? So, I'm going to tell you in a very short way that's easy to remember. Jesus was humble, so he did not stumble. I want you to repeat it. Jesus was humble, so he did not stumble. In other words, Jesus was humble. He never did anything selfish. He never did anything to hurt anyone else, and he never did anything to hurt his Heavenly Father's feelings. So now, back to Philippians chapter 2. And the Apostle Paul starts it something like this. If you are encouraged being with Christ, if comforted by his love, if you share in the Spirit, if you're tender and compassionate, then make me, meaning Paul, joyful and love and think like Jesus. Then Paul tells us what it means to be humble and think like Jesus. So what do? Do nothing out of selfish ambition. Don't be selfish. Value others above yourself. So value other people. All other people. And express concerns for others' interests. It's not always about what you want to do. It's about what other people want to do too. Then Paul gives us a picture of what it looks like when we apply that same humble Jesus thinking to all of our relationships with others. So what does a humble Jesus look like? Looks like sacrifice. Sacrifice like when King Jesus gave up his throne in heaven and came to earth to be a carpenter. He was a servant. Jesus served people. He healed people. He washed really dirty feet. Submission. Obedience. Jesus surrendered his will to the will of his Father. And suffering. He endured being treated badly just because of who he was. And he died on a cross for you and for me. No, Jesus was not weak. Jesus was strong, but he willingly humbled himself and put other people's needs ahead of his own. He lived a perfect life by being humble. And because Jesus willingly humbled himself, God the Father exalted him. And if we're willing to do the same, in due time, God promises to do the same for us. Citizen, thank you for your letter. Be safe, be healthy, and be humble, like Jesus.